This video will give just a very brief overview of some key issues in environmental economics. Probably the best way to study environmental economics is to focus on some very specific issues and to learn those issues very well, including some of the science. In this overall course, we'll be covering some of these issues, especially under the sections of water and food supply, but for now, let's just consider some broad topics that tend to reemerge in a lot of different issues of environmental economics. One thing that's clear is that there are still a lot of major economic problems in the world. According to estimates, 1.3 million people lack electricity, 800 million people lack an all-weather road, and adequate nutrition is far from universal. So there are many problems which require solutions. Those solutions will involve economic growth, and that economic growth will in some ways bring more pressure on the environment. Still, the human problems are considered truly pressing. One common attitude can be summed up by the saying, "First get wealthy, then go green." And arguably, the Western economies have done something like this. They grew very rapidly in the 19th century and much of the 20th century. They polluted quite a bit. At the time, they didn't worry about that pollution. Once they became wealthier in the era after World War II, then finally they started some measure of environmental cleanup. For the most part, China and a lot of other developing nations are following a similar path. That is, they're focusing on becoming wealthy first, and they'll worry about a lot of their environmental problems later. I'm not sure this is exactly the right attitude, but there is something to be said for it. That is, there are pressing human needs, a lot of people in poverty, and growth will improve those people's lives. It's also striking to see that a large number of environmental problems will improve with economic growth itself, but not all. Let's look at this more closely. As economic growth proceeds, a lot of air pollution problems become less serious. So consider this picture, which looks at what are called local and visible pollutants. What we find in this picture is that as nations become wealthier, on average their local and visible pollutants are decreasing. You can think of the poorer countries as needing to burn a lot of dirtier fuels or having more indoor air pollution, or in general just not having the resources to improve or clean up their air. There's also plenty of evidence that wealthier nations have cleaner water supplies. Yet, two points should be made here. The first is that not all pollution problems improve with economic growth. For instance, if we look at this picture, which considers CO2 emissions, in general, CO2 emissions go up as a country is becoming wealthier, because more wealth involves greater economic output, and that involves greater burning of fossil fuels, and then also higher CO2 emissions. The other point that should be made is even those pollution problems which improve with economic growth, they don't necessarily improve automatically. They improve often because the economy under question is doing something specific to worry about or take care of those pollution problems. It's also becoming more widely recognized that pollution itself may damage economic growth. A recent World Bank study looked at Ghana, Tajikistan, and China, and it found in those countries environmental problems may cost 9% of GDP a year, or possibly more. For the countries surveyed, the average cost was about 8% of GDP. Below you see a picture of Shanghai. This is air pollution in Shanghai, and in general, in Chinese cities, air pollution is a very serious problem, as it is in many Indian cities. One example of the economic costs of this air pollution is that it makes people less productive, it leads to them having greater health ailments, and overall, this lowers economic output. There's also a greater sense these days that resource damage can be costly to reverse, or in some extreme cases, perhaps impossible to reverse. So the attitude of grow now, go green later, again, may not exactly be correct. There may be some areas where you would prefer to address the environmental problems in advance because it would be, in the longer run, cheaper to do so. Still, there are a lot of concrete problems when developing nations try to address their environmental problems in advance. One problem is that very often in parts of those economies there are weak or poorly defined property rights. There also tend to be quite weak regulatory structures, just as many other institutions of governance may be weak. And there is also, at many times, a high degree or relatively high degree of corruption. All of those factors make it much harder for developing countries to address their pollution problems. One thing that's striking is how much the world as a whole is in some critical regards actually subsidizing pollution rather than trying to prevent it. So if we look at estimates, we find, for instance, that right now there are subsidies for fossil fuels at almost $500 billion worldwide. There are subsidies for water use, very often excessive water use, running $200 to $300 billion worldwide. There are subsidies for fisheries running in the neighborhood of $10 to $30 billion, and that usually involves an overuse of those fisheries and an inefficient rate of running down fish stocks. And there are $370 billion worth of subsidies for agriculture, and those often end up being subsidies to, indirectly, environmental degradation. Now, this is for the world as a whole, not just for developing countries, but in general, when you look at the policies of developing countries, we find that they, often in extreme form, follow the same paths of subsidizing polluting fossil fuels, especially dirty coal, subsidizing excess water use, sometimes excess subsidy to fisheries, and lots of subsidies to agriculture. So we can see here how difficult it can be to address pollution problems. It's not just a matter of getting pollution under control in some useful or efficient way, but rather reversing a set of policies that in some regards on net are right now subsidizing pollution. I would again stress the point that to learn environmental economics as it relates to development, you should focus your attention on very specific areas. And again, we'll cover some of those areas in this course, but by no means is it possible to cover all of them. But if you'd like one very general good introduction to environmental economics and development in general, you could start with an online World Bank report called Inclusive Green Growth.